stay whenever you get there. Stay inside the house and all that. And last night, the doctor was saying, Sunshine Pancake House, and it'll be right there on Thanksgiving Day
also, they're looking for contributions, turkey, cranberry sauce, things like that, and some financial help things. Also, if you know of a family that needs a Thanksgiving meal taken to them, we're going to try to distribute those into the community. This will be a joint church effort, community effort. So keep that in mind, and so just let me know, and I'll get those names into him, hopefully by the first or second Sunday in November. I'll let you know more specifics about that. Okay, are there any other announcements today? It's good to see you here. God bless you. Thank you for coming.
I have something that I'd like to share.
Okay.
A couple weeks ago, it was, or the 7th, it was Miss Frances Conner's 100th birthday. A century, which is unbelievable to me. And many things changed over that 100 years, but her smile has not changed one bit. She's beautiful. And I got some great pictures of her and her family, and I just wanted to share those with the congregation.
Amen. Good. Thank you. Okay. All right. Vivian?
Okay. Thank you to
Althea
and Alice.
Right. And I think we're kind of talking about after the first of the year, maybe having a pictorial directory made up, you know, so that's one of our goals we're thinking about. Okay, and that would be really good. Okay, any other announcement? Jester?
Yes, yesterday we got a good many gentlemen up and a couple of ladies to help with the parking yesterday, and we generated some income for the church, and we had a successful day. We hustled and got a little bit of money, so I want to thank everybody for helping.
Okay.
And it was a big ordeal, but we got it done. Thank y'all.
All right. I appreciate that. And I think we had there was a few issues with the parking part. No, we had it. But we figured out what part of the parking lot you should park in, right? Anyway, that's okay. I appreciate all that effort. We're really good.
I'm the only one who got stuff.
Yeah. Good job.
Okay. Any other announcements? Okay, we'll now move into our worship service, and we'll have our call to worship.
Our call to worship comes from 2 Chronicles, chapter 7, verses 12 through 14, and I'll be reading from the New King James Version. The Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said to him, I have heard your prayer, and I have chosen this place for myself as a house of sacrifice. When I shut up heaven and there is no rain, or command the locusts to devour the land, or send pestilence among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. And now we have our invocational prayer from Nicolette. Almighty and everlasting God, in Christ you have revealed your glory among the nations. Preserve the works of your mercy, that your church throughout the world may persevere with steadfast faith in the confession of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verses 17 and 18. Then you say in your heart, my power and the might of my hand have gained thee this wealth. And you shall remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you power to get wealth, that he may establish his covenant, which he swore to your fathers, as it is in this day. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen.
Now we come to the time of service where we share our joys and concerns. Are there any joys to be shared? I appreciate all the help. Okay, and the others, so I thank you for all the feral sheep we got. I was real surprised there. I got your pictures, and I sent them to you. Remember now, we're going to be having a photograph opportunity there outside the church after the service. Okay, any other joys to be shared? I had a visit. Shirley's not here this morning, but Reverend Farrell Cox, a good friend of mine, who was a good friend of Carl Harris this past week. Really good visit with him, and just good to sit around and visit somebody who's been a wonderful friend, he's a wonderful man, and a really wonderful supporter of me and my ministry all throughout the years. He was at the Catholic Church, retired and a Methodist minister. Another joy I have to share, we finally got a new conference done yesterday, you know, with, on Zoom. Okay, any others? Enjoyed having Denzel here today. Good to see you. Okay. Alright. And others. Okay, we're now moving into time where we have our share of concerns. Are there any concerns? You want to lift the Lord in prayer? I know you mentioned me that your Barbara, Linda. Okay. Also, I know David Graham lost his dog, beloved dog Bella, this past week. That's, you know, David and Bella, that's difficult. That's a very special. Any other concerns? Billy and Pat Harris. And I know that our folks in the nursing home are doing well. We're going to let us visit over there, bring them out for 15 minutes, but they decided to stop doing that because of the COVID situation. But not that they have a problem there, but maybe in other parts of the state and county. Continue to pray for our nation and all the different civil unrest and what's going on in the world. Are there any unspoken requests? We'll now have our call to prayer. Father, coming to you this morning, Lord, thanking you for this beautiful day, for this beautiful, wonderful time of year. Boy, things are going on. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, the freedom we have to worship you in the spirit and the truth, dear God, and to adore you, and to give glory to your name, dear God, and to give witness to others in this congregation in this world of our love for you and your love for us, dear God. Dear God, we thank you for all that you're doing in our church and in our world. Lord, we know that the message of Jesus is going forth. In spite of all that is going on, people are living the Christian life. In many cases, Lord, they're giving their life for the spreading of the good news of the gospel. We pray for them. We pray for them to have strength, and Lord, we pray for us to have their strength too. Dear God, help us to be faithful and true and steadfast in all that we do. Lord, we know this world is becoming a very difficult place to live in. To look at the news, there's a lot of things that can discourage us, and certainly does break our heart to see the suffering all around us and the needs. But Lord, we know that Jesus Christ is the answer. He is the way, the truth, and the life, dear Father. And Lord, we know that one day we will break through the glory if we stay true to you, dear God. Lord, we pray you will come back soon. We know that all things are in your hands, dear God, and ultimately you are in control of everything. And we're thankful, dear God, that we have a God like you that is the ruler of the universe, the creator of the universe, the creator of us, and is bringing breath into our hearts and our life, dear God, through the good news of the gospel and the power of the Holy Spirit to give us the strength to live this life in a meaningful, purposeful way. Dear God, we pray for the requests that have been lifted up this morning, dear God, for the broken hearts, for those who are facing very difficult situations as far as your health concerns. Dear God, we pray that you would heal them, the kind of healing that comes when we put everything completely and totally into your hands and realize, Lord, the seasons of our lives all completely and totally in your control, dear Father. And dear God, we just pray for healing, the ultimate healing that comes from knowing Jesus Christ and the peace that passes all understanding as we abide and meditate upon the good things of the gospel of Jesus Christ and the hope that we have. Lord, we pray your blessings upon this service. We pray your Holy Spirit would be with us, Father. Lord, we pray as we give our gifts to you as we leave, dear God, that you'll bless those gifts, and those gifts will be used for the furtherance of your kingdom and the spreading of the gospel and the good news. Dear God, we promise to be good stewards of all that we have given and brought into your church, dear Father. And now, Lord, we all pray together the prayer that you taught us to pray, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the glory, power, and glory, and the kingdom, forever and ever. Amen.
gospel reading from the book of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 through 34. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy, and where thieves break in and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will also be. The lamp of the body is the eye. If therefore your eye is good, your whole body will be full of light. But if your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in you is darkness, how great is that darkness? No one can serve two masters. Either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and men. Therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet their heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not more valuable than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add a cubit to his stature? So do not worry about clothing. Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. And yet, I say to you, that even Solomon, in all of his glory, was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For all of these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all of these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added to you. Therefore do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. Word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. Thank you very much. Where is your heart or your treasure? To a certain extent, this is a little bit of a kind of a follow-up from last Sunday's sermon. I'm taking from the book of Matthew here, this passage. The passage, I think I maybe mentioned this one time before, was the last passage that I actually heard my father speak from about a year or so before he began to not be able to preach because of his physical situation. And so it has some very precious memories for me there. So where is your treasure? Most of us here have heard of the story of Ali Hafed. Acres of Diamonds from Russell Cromwell. This is a story that he was the founder of Temple University. This is a story that he heard that actually changed his life. And hopefully, as we go in this passage, it will be something that will, while it may be very convicting, will be very encouraging about the way we should live our life and approach life. And the story goes something like this, that there was a farmer named Ali Hafed. And he had heard over in the African area, or the Eastern area, Persian area there. And he heard about how people had obtained wealth by finding diamonds. They were finding diamonds all over the place. And he was a farmer, part of the farmer, made a decent living. But he wanted to be wealthy and find diamonds. Of course, we know, we hear about the stories about how people strike the rich and all that kind of stuff. He became enchanted with that, and he felt like that what he needed to do was pursue that. So he sold his farm, left his family, and went all over the place mining and looking for diamonds. And he looked and he looked and he wandered and he wandered and he went and he went. And he never found what he was looking for. And ended up, I think it was somewhere like Barcelona, Spain, standing on the seaside and just on some cliffs and just out of despair, threw himself into the ocean because he had not found his diamonds. Sad story. Very sad. In a way, very sad. There's something to be learned from it, because the person who had purchased his farm
One day he was out with his camels and they stopped at this bubbling stream, and as his camel went down to drink, he noticed an unusual looking rock in the stream. It was kind of dark with a bluish hue to it, and it looked a lot different than other rocks. And he picked it up and he took it back to the farmhouse and put it above the fireplace or somewhere. And he didn't think nothing of it, but then somebody came and paid him a visit a couple of weeks later and saw that rock up there, and he said, "Where did you find that diamond?" I'm paraphrasing the story. Go read the story. It's not long. It's really neat. It's told a lot of different ways. But this is supposedly a true story. And anyway, we all know that diamonds are kind of rough, and they have to be sort of chiseled away at before they really. And anyway, that their farm turned out to be one of the richest diamond mines in that area. Okay? So, I guess the moral of the story is that sometimes people think that there's greener pastures over there. Okay? But sometimes the pasture's greener because the person who's taking care of that pasture is working it. Okay? And also, we need to kind of look around and try to understand, you know, where God has put us and bloom where we're planted. And don't necessarily be so envious of other situations and other people. Because a lot of times, true beauty and value is found right where you're at. I mean, for all we know, there might be some diamonds over there under that schoolhouse over there. Okay? seriously, God has planted us somewhere. And I would submit to you that there are diamonds, there are souls, there are human beings out there that need to know Jesus. And if our first passion will be Jesus and what he offers us in the cross and salvation, that we might have a really good harvest and be doing something really good here. And so I think that's kind of what I get from that. So, what occupies our minds? There are some myths out there, research that has said, supposedly research that says that men think about sex every 7 seconds. But they haven't figured out how they figured that out. Okay? The truth of the matter is we think about a lot of things, don't we? And one of the things we think about a lot is money. Okay? We think about health. We think about the money that is required to maintain that, family needs. Retirement, debt, budgets, and living within our means, wouldn't you say, especially with all that's gone on, with what we've had, especially with this pandemic, okay? But here we have, in this chapter 6, verses 19 through 34, part of the Sermon on the Mount is sort of a attitude about how we should look at money and wealth and possessions, okay? Treasure. Now, thing about money, wealth, possessions, or stuff, or whatever, is don't treasure it. Don't hold it too close. Don't be obsessed over it. Trust God for it. In 1929, the stock market crashed. A lot of people committed suicide. And it's really interesting when you go and read about that. They talk about people jumping off buildings. But there was a lot of people that just took their own life because they were so in despair about having lost their wealth and their investments and things like that. And it's so sad. It shows you how much so many people just put so much stock into possessions and wealth and stuff. One of the things that I find very interesting is the rather strange behavior of people who win the lottery. Some people win the lottery and it's like they go berserk. I mean, they kind of engage in behavior that is so unbecoming and so just not right, and just waste and squander it. I mean, they change. It does something to them. And they end up being very, very sorry, doing some very embarrassing things. But Jesus gives us, in this little passage here, 19:34, some very stark binary choices. Treasures on earth are treasures in heaven.
don't hoard things. Jesus is not against being responsible and having money, but he's concerned about where our true treasure really is. He gives us here two other perspectives or outlooks, the bad eye and the good eye, and then two masters serving money or serving God. I've always liked the word of the old King James, and I believe it's in the new King James Version, mammon. It has sort of a foreboding sound to it, you know, it's like, whoa, it's scary, okay? But Jesus is not for, he's not against us making decent salary or making money. And as a matter of fact, I think you can go to the book of Proverbs and see that it's recommended that we work hard, that we save money, and be responsible with it. And if we don't do that, then there are problems for people who are lazy and irresponsible. And the challenge for those of us who don't have money, or a lot of it, is to how do we utilize that, okay? And you see that a lot when you try to help the people who are coming to church for help. Many of them have some means, but they don't do a very good job of living within those means. As a matter of fact, I think it's a good idea for those of us to consider perhaps living somewhat beneath our means. I mean, do you really need that particular thing that you're going to go spend money on, okay? In the end, money gives us a lot of options, but those options tend to deteriorate over time. Okay? Rust, people can steal your money, people can fool you and pull tricks on you and take it from you. I think one of the biggest things we have to deal with nowadays is how many people who are elderly get preyed upon by people who are scamming them. I mean, we're living in a world where those kinds of things happen. On the other hand, eternal things, the things of God, are investments that last for eternity. And I think about the story of the widow's mite. And Jesus was standing there looking. He was looking at everything people were putting in our plate. You know? He looks when we put things in our plate, too. He's up there watching, okay? It's important to understand that. But the thing about it is that she was giving all that she had. She was giving her heart for things. Something that's very important. And I think about that song, Abide With Me. There's a very special passage in there that talks about how change and decay and all around I see about change to abide with me. Y'all remember that? Know that? That's it. That's very important. Is that Jesus Christ, the message of salvation of the Holy Spirit, and the life that he gives, that wellspring of eternal life that is in our hearts because of our belief in him, that springs up into everlasting life. We'll never die, we'll never go away. Now, God also tells us about having a good eye, a bad eye. Jesus in this parable tells us. I guess probably one of the best examples I can think of, good eyesight or bad eyesight, is how many here have ever had cataracts? Anybody here had good cataract surgery? I tell you what, that's one of the best things that ever happened to me. I may have told you this before, but I was going down there, coming down Highway 52, there's a ramp going up, and right, takes you right out, puts you right in front of the Darwin Raceway. And I was just going along, went up that ramp, and there was a warning that there was a stop sign there. I didn't see it, because I was leery from the cataract. And I ran the stop sign, and boy, a highway patrolman pulled me right over it like that. He saved my life, because I realized then I'd already been having some problems in the past, okay? And having to get different glasses and stuff like that. But he made me realize that I needed to go to cataracts. Okay? It's very important that you can ruin your life and other people's lives if you don't see very well. And, you know, that what was kind of humorous and kind of sweet about it, I may have shared this with you, is that I had that ticket, and it was a pretty good size ticket. It was nice to find a feeling. And anyway, I took and I called the folks in Darlington County, and this lady answered the phone. I told her about it, and I told her that I had cataracts and all that. And this little lady just prayed for me right off the bat. She said, let me say a little prayer for you, that somehow the Lord will work this out for you, and that you will be healed. Well, guess what? They reduced my fine, didn't take off any points. And but I wasn't like healed in the way Jesus would put his hands on me, Zach, whoever. But I did have a really good surgeon to take care of the situation. It was really good, really good. But you know, the thing about it is that, you know, physical eyesight, and it's kind of like with spiritual eyesight, we have to be able to see well spiritually. And Jesus is the light of the world, and we follow him, and we have that in our heart, we want to walk in darkness. And he will help us to be able to perceive things the right way. I mean, we all here are familiar with optical illusions. You know, there's one that I know that you can, like, look at something and you'll see a base. But then if you look at it a little bit longer, you'll see a face, you know. Have you ever looked at some of these things? Like, I saw something the other day on, it was on the internet where it showed a bunch of rocks and mountains and someplace over in Israel. Or somewhere that there were some mountain goats on it, that you had to pick them out, but you really had to look and see them, little things blended in, things like that. Well, in this world we live in, there are things that look good, but when you really look at it through spiritual eyes, it's not so good. And then there are things that look bad, maybe bad, but with God's help, you can see the good there. Okay? Spiritual eyesight. I remember one thing that really stands out in my mind when I first got here. I went to over the Presbyterian Church, the Proclaim Ministries service over there. And I was over there that night, and I think it was Donna Lay's daughter was doing a painting. You remember that, Karen? And she was up there. She's a wonderful artist. I think Donna was behind the thing singing a song or something. And she was painting, and I couldn't figure out what that was she was painting. But then they turned it around. It was a picture of Jesus, you know. Spiritual illusions. Right? I mean, you know, in order to be able to see correctly in this world, and things are going on in this fallen world, and with our fallen nature, we need to have Jesus in our heart to help us to see that, and to help us make right choices based upon that. Now, thirdly here, two masters. God versus money, the things of God. The thing about money and God is you really can't serve both at the same time. You got to be very, very careful. You have to put God first. With God first, you can put money in the right perspective and use it in a good and godly way. And that's very important to be able to do that. I guess the best example I could give you is this right here, is that I was riding around in Charlotte one time. And what I'll tell you, to me, Charlotte was hard to drive around in. Okay? I mean, I'm telling you, one of them. Because I had to go up there every now and then, because when I was in Chesterfield, people would be in hospital up there. Well, I've got OnStar. OnStar is good. OnStar said, take a right, take a left, do this, do that. Well, OnStar told me to take a left, and I was listening to OnStar, and I almost took that left. Unfortunately, there was a yellow light flashing, and there was cars coming the other way. But I had to use my eyesight and look at the right thing, okay? So you have, and that's kind of the way I see money. Money says something to you, as Cyrene Paul, and who does. I'll tell you another thing. Be careful with OnStar when you go to Aiken, in South Carolina. One place to reach. I'm here to tell you, that is a bad feeling. You get that one place straight, you look for a bathroom real quick. Okay, but anyway, but that's the way that, you know, money can just pull all kind of tricks on you. You know, I walked and wondered what I would do if I was riding down the road and I saw somebody riding down the road, a police car chasing them, and they threw a briefcase out the window. And I saw that briefcase, and I looked at it and found $100,000 in it. What would I do? You know, ask yourself, turn it into the IRS, tell the IRS about it. You know, but it presents a lot of challenges to us. Now, but then in this passage of scripture, it goes on to talk about some things that the problem that all of us have is that we have to learn how to deal with this anxiety that we have and about money and about things and about stuff, possessions. So Jesus said here, he says, therefore I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. It is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? And I would say amen to that.
Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather in the barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which if you by worry can add one cubit to his stature? Not one bit. You can't change anything by worry. And there's a difference between worry and being legitimately, maturely concerned about things. Okay? So, why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field. How they grow, they neither toil nor spin. Yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown in the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own thing. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. And I certainly think that in this day and time, with all that is going on, and we look what's going on out there, that we really need to really put ourselves in God's will and control, and live our life in God and the Spirit of God, live our life in the power of the resurrection. Okay? And I know I've shared this with you before, and I'll share it with you again. When I used to live in Spartanburg, South Carolina, they had there a school for the deaf and the blind where they taught those people, those folks, their trade so they could go out and make a living. Okay? And in the YMCA there were some gentlemen that worked in there who were, had learned how to give massages. They were blind, but they learned how to do that. And that is something that they were able to work and make really good tips. And there was one fellow, one day I was in there, and he was blind. He'd been working there for many years, and he was, I would put him in the category of being an elderly gentleman. But he was in the pool, the whirlpool bath, and he was singing with a booming voice. I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. But his eyes on the sparrow, and I know he's watching over me. And just the way he sang, that booming voice, and knowing that he was blind, that God was watching over him, it was so inspiring. And the fact that somebody with that kind of situation had to deal with, could have that kind of song in his heart, really touched me. It was amazing. It's one of those breathless moments that you never forget. And you've heard me say this before, somebody else has said it, life isn't about how many breaths you take. It's about how many breathless moments you have to make you realize how fortunate and lucky you are to be alive, and especially as a Christian, to have God's Spirit in your heart, God's light in your heart, and to know God and to know Jesus. So don't worry. God will provide. He is Jehovah Jireh. And God does love, and he does care for us, and that's why he's given us his word in this passage in the New Testament, and Jesus' teaching, to show us how to live life and approach life, make this world a better place, and win other people to Jesus. And that's the word of God for the people of God. Okay, we'll now stand, and we'll have the Apostle Creed. It's up there on the screen. The affirmation of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Take my life and let me consecrate it, Lord, to Thee. Take my movements.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.